Folks, it is Sunday, 10:30 a.m. Worship time! So I invite you to prepare your hearts to be in communion with God. Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Welcome to First United Methodist Church in Bartow. We are so glad you are all here. We might have guests today behind the masks. I'm not able to tell who is everybody, but please know that you are welcome. We are so glad that you came to worship with us. I have good news. Finally, the work in the porch has begun.
Woo-hoo!
So if you drove by last Wednesday, you might have seen the workers there grinding. The floor has to be ground first. It's already leveled and grounded well. And this week they might install all the tiles, the new tiles. So by next Sunday, our sanctuary might have the doors, the front doors open and a beautiful facade. We're so glad. We also want to announce that the pastors in Bartow, we are in conversation to be able to, we're hoping, and I don't see why not, why the city would not allow us to have an Easter sunrise service, and as we have always done, except for last year, an Easter sunrise service at Mosaic Park on the pavilion, and a crosswalk that we always do. We walk from different points in the city into this park here, which is called the Fort Blount. Thank you. The Fort Blount Park, where we do at noon a Good Friday service, and we walk with the cross. So if you want to carry the cross to follow Jesus, you're invited that day. Easter is on April the 4th. And from that you can tell when is Good Friday and when is Palm Sunday, is March the 28th. So we invite you to all of these activities. This week our activities will be the usual. Monday, tomorrow, 10 a.m. prayer. Wednesday, 7 p.m. Bible study. And also the youth. So we invite you to all these activities. As more and more and more people get vaccinated, our attendance might begin to increase finally. We're not there yet. We are not ready to announce that we will return to our fellowship dinners. Not yet. I know you miss them. I miss them too. I miss having more chances to talk to everybody. But we're getting closer. So if we continue praying, we might be able to do it. Now, Sunday school is beginning a week from today, next Sunday. So please, if you have children in your community, this coming Sunday, beginning on March the 7th, which will also be Communion Sunday, a week from today, we will begin Sunday school classes for children. And the beginning time will be 9:30. So we are thankful to Miss Melanie. So remember, if there are children around in your neighborhood, we're here, we're open for them. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice
and be glad
in it. Amen.
Today's call to worship comes from the book of Psalms, chapter 19, verses 1 through 6. The heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hands.
I'm going to wait for the slide to be able to show you. Day after day, they pour forth speech. Night after night, they reveal knowledge.
They have no speech. They use no words. No sound is heard from them.
Yet their voice goes out into all the earth, their words to the ends of the world. In the heavens, God has pitched a tent for the sun.
It's like a bridegroom coming out of his chamber, like a champion rejoicing to run his course.
It rises at one end of the heavens and makes its circuit to the other. Nothing is deprived of its warmth. You're going to hear an awful lot of references to the sun today through our music, because it kind of works along with what Pastor Armando is using for his scripture. And so I invite you to stand and praise with us as we sing about a song that tells us, from the rising to the setting sun, his love endures forever. Please pray with us.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise. Outstretched arm, his love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn, his love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. To the setting sun, his love endures forever, and by the grace of God we'll carry on. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, and forever God.
seated, and we invite our children to come have a moment of children's time with Miss Ina.
Today, boys and girls, I brought a box. We're going to think about boxes today. This isn't a very big one, is it? And look, it's from Amazon. Oh, my. You probably get some boxes like that at your house, don't you? Well, boxes are important, aren't they? Can you think of something you'd put in a box? Maybe some toys? Or a book? Some pencils? How about a car?
No.
No, that'd be too big, wouldn't it? We couldn't put a car in a box, especially this box. This isn't very big, but there is something in it. What about God? Do you think we could put God in that box?
No.
Well, some people, it seems like they're putting God in a box.
No.
Yeah, because when they just ask God for little things like, "Dear God, just help me today." That's kind of a little prayer. It's good. But what about, "And dear God, help my friends. And this lady over here, she's sad. Help her today too. And there's other people in our city. Can you help all those people too?" We can pray big because our God is so big. He is so big. We can have big prayers. Yeah. Well, you know what? We're going to see what's in this box. I want you to count to three, and I'm going to pull this string. Ready? One, two, three. What is in this box? Oh, my goodness. What is this? Whoa. Oh my goodness. Look. It's a little box. It's a monkey puppet. Oh, my goodness, a monkey puppet. Oh, look. Oh, he can talk. What? Oh, he says there's something in here. Oh, he's right. There is. Oh, my goodness. Let's set the box down. Let's set it down over here. Now, that's all gone. Well, oh, he wants me to read what's on the card. Oh, wait a minute. Oh, it's 1 Corinthians 2:9. It says, "No eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has conceived what God has prepared for those who love him." So that means we can pray really big to God, big things, because we just can't imagine what God's going to do. And did you know next week Sunday school? We need to pray for Sunday school. We need to pray for children to come. Let's don't pray just for one. Let's pray for lots of children to come. Let's don't put God in the box and say, "He can only bring one child." He can bring lots. Let's pray believing, because we have no idea what God has prepared for him. Miss Melanie, we don't know how many's going to come. A lot, maybe. Let's pray. And all you moms and dads and grandmas and grandpas out there, pray. Pray for our Sunday school so that the children will come and learn about Jesus. Oh, what? He said there's a song on the back. My God is... I know this song. Maybe you know it too. Let's see. Listen to what it's all about. My God is so big. My God is so mighty, there's nothing my God cannot do. My God is so big, so strong and so mighty, there's nothing my God cannot do. Oh, okay. He made the trees, he made the seas, he made the elephants too. and the monkeys. Yeah. My God is so big, so strong, and so mighty. There's nothing my God cannot do. Isn't that amazing? So let's don't put God in a box and think he can't do much. He just does one little thing. God can do little things, and God can do big things. There's nothing my God cannot do. Thank you. What's your name? Coco. Coco. Well, Coco, will you come back? You know, Cindy usually comes, but she didn't come today. Will you come back, and maybe you and Cindy? Oh, okay. That sounds good. Well, let's pray right now. Let's all bow our heads and pray. Dear God, thank you that you are so big and so mighty, and you can do wonderful things. And Lord, I just pray for our church, and I pray that you'll bring the people and bring the children to Sunday school and just help our town of Bartow, Lord, to learn about you and our whole state and our whole country. And we just pray big, Father, because we know you can do great things. And we ask all this in your name. Amen. Okay, sit by.
Singing.
tender heart is beating, we can live together. Love will be our home. Love will be our home. And love will be our home. Love will be our home. And love will be our home. Wherever there is laughter ringing, someone smiling, someone dreaming, we can live together there. Love will be our home, and love will be our home.
Well, kind of continuing with our metaphor on the idea of sunlight and kind of what light brings into our lives, this next song, which we're very glad that Amy is back that we can do this morning, and we're also glad that she's back just because we've missed her, talks about the idea that we were in darkness, and the only thing that brought us out of that darkness was God's love, reflected through Jesus' life to be able to provide our salvation.
To a virgin came the word from a throne of endless.
I would invite you to stand to sing this last number with us this morning, because our God truly is great. He's a wonderful God, he's a splendid God, he's a majestic God, he's a great God. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice. Our scripture this morning comes from the book of Psalm, chapter 19, verses 7 through 11. The law of the Lord is perfect, refreshing the soul. The statutes of the Lord are trustworthy, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, giving joy to the heart. The commands of the Lord are radiant, giving light to the eyes. The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The decrees of the Lord are firm, and all of them are righteous. They are more precious than gold, than much pure gold. They are sweeter than honey from the honeycomb. By them your servant is warned. In keeping them, there is great reward. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Hallelujah! Praise God! I'm a Cuban Methodist. That means that I have to say praise God and raise my hands. And I also learned one more thing that I am sure you learned too, and that is that we can pray to God for healing. The power of God is present with us today. So I invite you to bow our heads and pray not only for the sermon, which we will also do now, but let's pray for those in our church who need a healing touch from God. Let's bow our heads. Dear God, as we come together this morning, we feel your presence. You are here. Thank you, God, that your promises are being fulfilled. Wherever two or three are gathered in my name, I am there. And I know, God, we know you are also at home with our brothers and sisters who are watching from home. There are so many people that need today, God. As a matter of fact, there is nobody that does not need your touch, one way or the other, God. So we pray for all of us that your Holy Spirit will be moving with freedom and that we will learn to cry out to you and be clear about our requests and our needs so that you can move, so that you can answer us, God. We pray for Betty Wetherington, who had a successful surgery, but now she is in a rehab center. We pray that she will be able to recover all her movements and control of her feet. We pray that therapy will work well so that she will recover her mobility. We pray for Ken, her husband, as they are now missing each other. We pray, God, for Barbara Weaver, who is here with us this morning. We thank you for her presence, her ministry. We thank you for the beauty of her ministry, God, and Chuck. And we pray for both of them that they will continue to be a light in this world, which is in darkness, God. We pray, God, for Mr. Kruger, Keith Kruger, and his brother Dean, that they will both be healed from the same illness that they are enduring. We pray, God, for Bill Sheets. We thank you that he sang for us so beautifully this morning and he might need surgery. We pray, God, that you will cover with them with the power of your Holy Spirit. We pray, God, for those who are in their nursing homes or at home, shut in. You are not shut out of our lives, God. So we pray that they will feel your presence. We pray that we will be able to visit with one another. We pray, God, for those who are suffering the loss of a dear friend or a dear girlfriend. We pray, God, for those who are today hungry or thirsty. Provide, God, for those who do not have jobs. Provide, God. For those who do not have guidance, provide the guidance, God. Provide the light from the Holy Spirit, from your scriptures, so that we will know how to move forward as a nation, as a church, as a family, individually. Give us guidance when we are looking about the next step in our lives, God. We pray, God, that we will learn that together, when we come together in harmony, when your children are living as brothers and sisters, that is where you send blessings, joy, and life, and eternal life, God. God, reconcile us with you and with one another, and help us to abide by your Holy Scripture. In your name we pray. Amen. 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 The scripture today, as has been clear from the beginning, From the call to worship, we have been talking about Psalm 19. A beautiful psalm. If you want to prepare and read ahead for next Sunday, the psalm we're going to talk about next Sunday is Psalm 73, which addresses a question that still today there is no answer or a full answer for it. Psalm 73. Why are righteous people suffering, whereas people who do evil or do wrong, they're prospering? It's a paradox. We will talk about that next Sunday from Psalm 73 again. But today, we're talking about the beauty of creation as expressed to us by Psalm 19. And it looks, when you look at this psalm, how many of you read it this week? How many of you? Oh, I saw a hand. That's awesome. I saw another one. Good. Psalm 19. When you look at it at first glance, it looks like a jigsaw or a puzzle that was not well put together. That's what it looks at first. Because on the first verses that we had in the call to worship, verses 1 through 6, it is about creation. It's about the sun rising up and then going down. And it's about the warmth and the light and all. It's about creation. And then there is a shift in verses 7 through 14. And then we're talking about the law of God. How do the two fit together? How was that shift from creation to the law of God? Well, that is precisely the point. The title of my sermon this morning, let me look at that screen. It's what so well put together. The beauty and perfection of God's law. Good job, Ali. So the beauty and perfection of God's law. Psalm 19 is not a Frankenstein of a chapter where different pieces from different parts were put together and they don't really fit. Actually, Psalm 19 is a beautiful psalm that illustrates from the beauty of creation, from the perfection of how our world functions, we should also learn that in the same way, the law of God is perfect and beautiful and good for our soul. So, in those verses, we have a description, verses 1 through 6, of how creation speaks. And you can read that in different ways. You could say, verse 1, Psalm 19, verse 1, the heavens declare the glory of God, the skies proclaim the work of his hands. You could read that and say, okay, creation is talking about the fact that there is a God. Creation tells us that there is a God. And that would be true, except that for the Israelites, that was a given. They were believers. So it goes a step forward, not only that there is a God, but God is behind everything that exists, putting everything in place. From chaos, God created the order that we see in creation. That's how creation happens, by God ordering things and putting limits to things, the seas. You cannot go farther beyond this point. And then the earth was gathered together in one place, and the stars were giving a course, and the sun and the moon, and everything is put together in a way that, according to Psalm 19, it says, day after day, they pour forth speech. There is speech that comes out of creation. Night after night, they reveal knowledge. It's a knowledge that scientists study, but the Bible goes beyond that. It's not a scientific knowledge that you can acquire through a telescope. You acquire it by tuning your life to the notes of God's creation that came from the fingers of the Lord. So Psalm 19 is a parable, so to speak, an illustration. In the same way as the sun rises from the east, sets from the west, and it says nothing escapes from its warmth. Nothing escapes from the law of God, from the beauty of the commandments of the Lord. Nothing escapes from the designs that God has set for this world. And then that's the beauty and the perfection of God's law. It is there as creation so that it can support life. The law of the Lord supports life, just as creation supports life. And we when we study the law of God in this way, we will see that it is so much more than we think it is. So I have been using the term law because it is the most common translation of the Hebrew Torah. But in reality, Torah primarily does not mean law. It means instructions. It means teaching. It means guidance. And there is a lot more in Torah that is not a series of do not do these commandments. The law of the God, of the law of the Lord is teaching, is wisdom for ourselves. So think about this. What do we call Torah? We call Torah, the law, the first five books of the Bible. And what do we have in them? The book of Genesis. The word says it. Genesis, the story of how creation was put together. Now this Psalm 19 makes more sense now. So in the book of Genesis, chapters 1 and 2, we have stories of how creation was put together. And then we have how the people originated. And then we have the history of how God chose one people out of one man who was obedient, Abraham. So we have the story of creation. We have the story of Israel as a nation. We have anecdotes. We have genealogies. Where do each of us come from? Genealogies. There are many genealogies in the book of Genesis. Then we have liberation, the stories of how the people of God was liberated from Egypt, from slavery, and was given a land that overflows with milk and honey. Did you think about the law as liberating? But the law is. It gives us freedom, the law of God, the instruction, the wisdom of the Lord is to give us freedom. So all of those things we have in the Torah, we have guidance for how to do worship. The book of Leviticus. We have in the book of Numbers, a beautiful book about all the miracles of the Lord, how God was providing for Israel when they were in the desert. Those beautiful miracles, how God provided water and food and dress, clothing for Israel as they were in the desert going into Israel, protection from their enemies. All of those things are in the first five books of the law. And then you have the book of Deuteronomy, which means the second Deutero, second nomos, Greek for law. A second narration, because one was not enough. So we hear it twice in the book of Deuteronomy. And then we get the rest of the Bible, which we also refer to as the law of God by extension. So you see, when we do that, then the meaning of law opens up for us. It is not boring or monotonous. It is fascinating. It is intriguing. The law of God is not restrictive or punitive. It's not about the type of punishments that you get when you do something wrong. How many times are you slapped with the ruler when you speak out of turn in class? No, it's not about that. it's not about being punitive, but being liberating. It's about helping us to grow into what God meant us to be. It's not oppressive. It is not discriminatory. It doesn't show preference of one people over other people. We have a misconception about the people of Israel. They are chosen. They're chosen as servants. The people of Israel, they are chosen so that they can teach the rest of the world how to obey God. They're not chosen as rulers over the rest of the nations. Being chosen by God means that you're going to be a servant of the Lord. So it is not about do not do commandments, but it is about do these other things, such as the commandment to love. It is about how we are all created equal. Before God, we are all created equal. However, we are also all created special before the Lord. So this is another important part. The law of God is not antiquated. It's not outdated. It's not repressive. It's not something that we have to break out from. The law of the Lord is still full of potential. It opens up our imagination into the future. So that if we guide ourselves by the law of God, our future will be even brighter. So therefore, it cannot be set aside and disregarded, like if it was something that is not relevant anymore. When interpreted through the eyes of Jesus and under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, the law of the Lord is what Psalm 19 says. So let's go through the beauty of this poetry. Verses 7 through 9. The law of the Lord is perfect, refreshing for the soul. And see now all the words that are going to be used as synonyms of law. The statutes of the Lord are trustworthy, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, giving joy to the heart. Did you ever think about the law giving joy? We always think about the law as chains that we have to live under. No! The law of the Lord is right, giving joy to the heart. The commands of the Lord are radiant, giving light to the eyes. It shows us the way so that we don't sink or slip or trump or stump over something. Now, this one is interesting. The fear of the Lord is pure. Why is the word fear there as a synonym of all of the above? Law, commands, statutes, precepts, etc. Because the fear of the Lord is precisely knowledge that the Lord of God is good. That is what the fear of the Lord is. Knowledge that the law of the Lord is good. The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The decrees of the Lord are firm, I am sorry. If somebody wants to do away with them, I'm sorry. The decrees of the Lord are firm, and all of them are righteous. They are more precious than gold, more than pure gold. So, my brothers and sisters, we need to call ourselves into question and ask a few important toshi. We need to raise a few important thorny issues. Number one. Now do not think about those who are breaking the law. Think about yourself and myself. Do we pay attention? Do we study? Do we enjoy? Do we find pleasure in the law of the Lord? Where is it in our house? How often do we open it up? Or maybe for some of us in today's world, how often do we turn it on? Either way. Bottom line, how often do we read it? In Israel, in the book of Deuteronomy, we have the Shema. It's like the Lord's Prayer. It's like you were supposed to say it every single day when you were waking up, before you stepped out of your bedroom, and then again at night as you go to bed, you meditate on the beauty of the Lord. And the Shema is a Hebrew word that means listen, O Israel, listen. Pay attention, listen to this. The Lord God is one. There is no other God. And thou shalt love your God. That's what the Shema is. It's from Deuteronomy chapter 5 and chapter 6. You should love God. That's the summary of the law. It's not punishment. It's to teach us to love one another. Love the Lord with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your might, with all your mind. Love your neighbor as you love thyself. So the law of the Lord is something that we need to meditate on every single day. The Israelites, those who took it literally, it's not meant to be taken literally, but seriously. But those who take it literally, they tied up the laws of God to their wrists, or they put it in their head. Sometimes you see Orthodox Jewish people with the law, the symbol of the law of God here in their forehead, or tied up to their wrist. And then sometimes they go around several times, and you see they have something that they wrap around their arms, because they don't want to lose sight of the law of the Lord. So how important is it? How important is the law of God for us? How often do we go to it, to meditate on it? Now let me read other verses from Psalm 19. This is a beautiful part that we all should pay attention to. I'm going to read now verses 12 and 13. And it says, who can discern their own errors? Forgive my hidden faults. Keep your servant also from willful sins. May they not rule over me. Then I will be blameless, innocent of great transgression. You see, there is one problem with getting old. I can tell you about those. One of the problems with getting old. Some people say you lose your memory. You might lose your memory about what happened 5 minutes ago. But you don't lose your memory about what you did 15, 20, 40 years ago. And then you say, wow, how dumb I was. How dumb I was. And then you say, ouch, When I think about what I did, that was not the best choice that I made. And God doesn't remind us of those things so that we punish ourselves, so that we flog ourselves. Rather, so that we can learn the way ahead of us and so that we can pass on those lessons to the new generations. So what do we say to the new generations? We tell them, hey, these are the mistakes I made. You would be wise not to make the same mistakes. You would be wise not to do the same foolishness that I committed. And that way we learn from tradition. We learn from tradition. We learn from those who came before us and left for us a reservoir of knowledge and wisdom so that we can know our way forward. So my brothers and sisters, listen to the word of God, their freedom for us, so that we do not put chains upon ourselves. We need to pray so that as a society, we do not lose sight of the importance of the law of God. I have to tell you, I heard a sermon by a very eloquent pastor. A very eloquent pastor. Very convincing. If you don't pay attention, very convincing about how outdated the Bible is. And I was so scared when I heard that. Very eloquent. How we need to surpass, set aside the law of God. I guess this pastor did not read Psalm 19. But we have, and we know that it is not chains upon ourselves. It is the warmth, it is the light, it is the beauty that comes from the sun. It is life. The word of the Lord is life for all of us. And I invite our church and our world today to not set it aside. Now, one thing is true, and we do that when we read it through the eyes of Jesus Christ. That's not something that the church invented. The Israelites read it through the eyes of their rabbis, the eyes of their teachers. So we're not deviating from what Israel does. We only realize that we have one rabbi, one teacher, one master, who taught us to read the Bible through the eyes of love, the supreme commandment. But love cannot be used as an excuse to do whatever I want. That's the danger that we have in the Western world. Trying to find a balance between individual freedom, which is given by God, and the law of the Lord for the community, so that we can all live together in harmony. In harmony. What happens when we step out of what God has given us is like a meteorite that comes out of nowhere and hits the earth and kills life. So we pray, as we read Psalm 19, we pray that God will take control of our lives, that we will surrender. We should talk, we should meditate about God's law, and we should surrender to God's word. We should rededicate ourselves to the beauty of these scriptures. Meditate on them daily, and then we will see prosperity and life. Let's bow our heads and pray. Dear God, we pray with Psalm 19. We pray, Lord, May these words of my mouth, let the meditation of our hearts be pleasing into your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. In your name we pray. Amen.
We're going to sing a great old hymn, Trust and Obey. And we'll sing all four verses with an interlude after the third. I wouldn't believe that when I was a child and my father was trying to make me obey. We learned that with our grandson. I hope he's not listening. That obedience is something good. You know what we did once, my wife and I, we were sitting with him and we told him, hey, we're going to teach you a new word. We're going to teach you the word obedience. And then we gave him example after example. Okay, if your mom tells you not to play with fire, what would be obedience in that case? And then he says, not to play with fire. Good. We all need to learn that, you know. We all, it's not only when we were children. Little by little, God is teaching us how to conform ourselves to God's plan for us. And that's not a slavery. That is to flourish
and to be who God meant for us to be. So as we depart from this place, I invite you to flourish. I invite you to shine like the sun. I invite you to be a source of warmth for those around you. They might be cold. They need somebody to come and give them some warmth. You can be, I can be the source of that warmth if we let the rhythm of the scripture be beating in our hearts for us to be the blood circulation in our world today. No more anatomy, no more creation classes. Let's go and do it. Let's go and sing for the Lord. May the blessings from God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be with all ourselves, with our minds, with our hearts, with our bodies, so that we are all ordered according to the will of God for us. Go and be joyful. Amen.